to be emceeing this talk, but unfortunately her son is very ill and she's unable to attend, so I'm filling in at the last minute. And joining me up here on stage today is Zara Pasfield and Juune Lee, aka Timothy Lee, which I'm going to interchange the name. Welcome, we're at the Vivid Ideas at Chatswood Chase talk series. This is a series of talks at 11 o'clock every morning during the entire Vivid Festival. We've curated a series of talks on art, design, technology, and the environment. So there's some programs on your seats, and check out some of the other amazing talks we've got over the coming weeks. So, Vivid Sydney at Chatswood this year, we have had a real focus on developing emerging talent through our Limelight Academy on the concourse, as well as a collaboration with the University of Sydney. So we've been really engaging lots of younger artists and helping them realise some of their projects. Through us putting together this talk series, I realised that we had two amazing artists that I'd worked with over the last 9 months who we didn't really need to give much support to. Been incredibly impressed by their commitment, their quality of output, their professionalism, and they are the youngest by far of the artists that we've been working with. Some in the program are twice the age of these two on the stage right now. So I thought it was quite fitting to have a organiser's talk today with Zara and Juune. You can see the sort of emerging lights in this field of light, art and design. I've come from a visual arts background, and working with artists who have these digital skills is really amazing, and to me, it's really amazing to have them at such a young age. So, what we're going to do is we're going to have a chat, we're going to show some slides and videos, and then we'll open up to questions at the end. I'm going to start with you, Zara. Can you tell us a little bit about your background?
And
do you feel about being part of this year?
It's just like a pretty good opportunity to be honest. We usually come, this is the first like public artwork I've done. We usually do just like underground, like warehouse things and art galleries and stuff like that. So it's good to like be part of the whole public art.
It's good stuff.
I'm asking a question I know the answer to, but I think it's interesting for other people. How did you get involved in this music industry?
Right, so I actually applied for the Limelight Academy on campus, but I actually didn't get it. But Juliet was like, actually, we have another opportunity that we can give you is if you have like an artwork down by a master. Yeah, because you can see what you can do with that.
So I think Tim applied for the Limelight Academy, which is our projection mapping academy that we did with 6 international students. He was unsuccessful, but I did pull him from that to create something else, which I think is really good being as an artist. Sometimes you need to put yourself out there to not know where to take you. And Tim then created a piece that we sort of came up with. We decided to create like a Hollywood sign based on Chatswood, which is based on a Henry Wilson poem, and then Tim designed the visuals for it. And I think if we can show the video for that, we can show Tim's video in a few minutes. So Tim, tell us about how you put this together before we see it.
Right, so originally you asked me to do something which is inspired by but I think like living in our town and like living quite close to it and spending like a lot of my time in Chatswood, I guess like my idea of it is like very like different, it's very multicultural, it's like a, even though I'm probably like quite critical of like multicultural from like a wider scale of like Australia, and the really area is actually quite good and it's quite inclusive. And there's lots of cultural things as well, and I think from growing up in Australia it's something to remember about. So I tried to like, I guess, open up the idea of like what this area like has been and will be, and like, yeah, this doesn't last the future basically.
What I really loved working with you, Tim, is your tenacity going into the library and finding all of these archival images, and you really dive deep into the brief, which was, use this poem as a starting point, but then took it where he wanted to go, and he's created a really beautiful, quirky piece of work that I think really perfectly encapsulates the history of Chatswood, it's very place-specific artwork. Okay, good to go. Okay, so we'll watch it now. If you haven't seen it, it's done in the Muslims of Change Chatswood, but this is just the way you are. the actual projection image, but it is projected on what we end up in, actually 10 meters?
Yeah, I think it's about like 10 meters by 1.6
meters side. Yeah. Can you tell, I know some of the references in there, but now that everyone's seen it, can you point out some of the very specific historical references that you put in that piece that really relate to the chapter?
Sure. So the idea was to try and like tell a story and as well kind of like capture like a kind of like I guess like a sort of part of the culture for each era. And so there's the pre-colonial era, which is the indigenous time, there's the colonial era, and then there's like the modern time, which is full of like the multicultures and the heavy Chinese immigration. And so each period is represented actually by a different kind of art style. So the first one is represented by Gambirra's paintings in indigenous times, and then the colonial time is found, you know, the found resources found in like the archives of like the Willoughby library. And the last one, which is represented in modern time, is the 3D renders, which I personally. And so the idea is that every single era kind of adds upon itself, and so even though like certain aspects of the culture kind of disappear, at the end everything's built up on top of each other, so it kind of creates like a collage style with like three different eras.
And the opening scene of the lady is Charlotte.
Yeah, it's Chatty. Yeah, the actual
Chatty.
Yeah.
So Chatty's Wood is a poem by Henry Lawson, which describes where Chatswood got its name from. And it's named after a woman called Chatty Charlotte, who used to come into the woodland and paint birds. Is that what you
yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so the poem says that she's a dream. But I think actually it's like the dream is like code for how she used to like paint. And so I looked up like a couple of different resources.
And it's a beautiful piece if you're down there in the interchange. You've got the orchard pub behind you, but then you've also incorporated that into your work. So you see it in this artwork, and then you see the actual building behind it, which is quite cool. And then at some points, when the trains are on your screen, you've got the actual trains going past. So it's quite a fun work in situ as well. Thank you, Tim. So Zara, back to your work that you created for Juliet and Gambirra. Can you tell us a bit about where you got the inspiration for the Cascading Harp and take us on that journey?
Well, I'd like to say that mine is a little bit more historically informed, but the Cascading Harp was informed a little bit more by the theme for the precinct, which was love, peace and music. So through Cascading Harp we were looking at, or inspired by, prominently Nepalese embedded writers, hanging them in high places, Juune takes those messages and goes them through the community, and that's something that we were trying to do. We were Cascading Harp. Obviously, it's a 3 meter tall mining installation, so it's the colour and the sound created by the bells on the end of each rope, so we were letting that music transfer through the community here.
And I went on this journey with you, so tell me about some of the challenges face.
Yes.
As from the moment that Zara presents a theme with some concepts in what? October-ish. This is one that I really liked. But we first of all had to find where it was going to go.
Yeah, we went through a couple of different sites, exploring how it worked on laneways, potentially infrastructures, freestanding, but eventually found the site and it just would interchange that gave us the height that we needed to achieve what we wanted to through that one. So the other troubles that came with that were the height, creating something that is 3 meters tall, 15 meters tall, sorry, three stories tall.
It's about
yeah, exactly. And weighing 1.5 tons definitely came with its own challenges. Looking at the structural engineering, how on earth we're going to get it in the space. We also had to work with the fact that we were creating a hanging work that was going to be in around head height. which came in the end with a little bit of alteration to where we were hanging it and how people were interacting with it, purely down to safety concerns and things like that. Yeah, and then physically with the work itself, there was the trial and error with the materiality and working out what was durable enough for constant movement and interaction, as well as being exposed to the elements. But I think first and foremost, the formidable size of the work was its greatest challenge.
And what are some of the lessons you learned from creating that piece? Are there things you do differently or you do again?
I think what I would do moving forward, or maybe the setback, particularly in the site itself, that came with its challenges. We were getting a really small look there and working out how to look at planting. I would probably work a little bit more backwards. That sort of feat of engineering, I probably start working engineering first.
Yeah.
Working closely with Juliet and her team to achieve the installation of the actual work. That'd be my biggest takeaway, I think. Yeah. The aesthetic was the easy bit in the end.
Yes. I think that's something really important for lots of artists. I'm very big on site-specific artworks and things created for a specific location. We did jump ahead and think with that location without thinking about how it was going to get in there. Yes. And when you're going to that height, you actually need to have a really big crane. But then, will it even fit? And will the ground hold it? And all of these things that you often don't think about caused us many late night, early morning headaches.
Yes. And also things like there was an implementation we added in terms of technology as well, having access to reprogram it. So once it's rigged, you can't really access it. And it was a stroke of genius, I think, from Chris Daniels' part, who worked with the technology side of it, that we incorporated a hanging access cable that allowed us to coordinate all the animations halfway through, which has become very crucial. Is access to the work.
Something I learned on that project is getting very clear about who has to approve it. We kind of left that to the last minute, and we were all in nail biting. 5 p.m. Can we install it tomorrow night unless we get the rail to approve it, which we finally got. But that was a pretty scary moment for the install.
Definitely,
lots involved,
and we do lots of trips for all this stuff here. But we got the other thing there in the end, and it looks great. And all of it was gone.
It's a little time ago, isn't it? And Chris, we also went through quite a few challenges. Do you want to talk us through some of the things that you've learned and difficulties you experienced putting
your piece together? Yeah, so I think probably like one of the biggest challenges was just getting everything properly installed with like OHS and stuff. Anyone we used to do is definitely above part four. We usually put 50 kilogram projectors onto the wheel crates, which then tie together.
Yeah.
So cable ties, that's a very different experience. Really fun. Yeah, so we really put up with doing that kind of stuff. But for instance, like the size has changed quite a lot because we wanted to like build it to be taller originally, but if it goes above 1.6, then it's still supporting views and stuff like that.
And the projection would fit it.
I think personally, probably one of the biggest challenges I think is finding a lot of information about pre-colonial times, and it will be indigenous history has no history, and there's no way of having any people left. And so all the information that we did find was basically, we talked to the Aboriginal Heritage Office, and really it was just a lot of inferences about how they used to live, and the environment. Because we don't actually have any records of how they used to live for it. And I think even all the local history books have the same like, two paragraphs. And so things about like the fishing culture and stuff like that was something that we inferred from that the Lane Cove River used to be much more prominent back like before colonial times. But then it now it's not as big and not as much of like the local culture called the dumping. So, yeah, that's probably, that was probably one of the challenges.
It's nice that you've got such a history lesson creating a piece of artwork. And Zara, I know with your
that'll be something that we'll approach with future locations, that we'll look at altering that, where best, how it can be adapted to our spaces.
And to also your work up or anywhere else, very Chatswood specific, what other projects or things are you working on?
I have a couple of music videos that I have to do some animation for. And I think I'm going to do some personal projects again. Yeah. Build this way. So, just take it for
that. Okay, well, I think that's all the questions I'm going to ask you about your clients' work for us here in Sydney. I'm just going to open it up to the floor. If anyone has any questions, or Zara and the team.
Hi, both Zara and Tim. I just wanted to know from both of you what was, I guess, an interesting or out there fact that you learned about Chatswood during the process of making and installing your installations.
I learned more about the social and sheer number of humans in Chatswood at all times. During the installation, we were installing at night time, and there were intimately people moving through, taking photos, constantly curious about what was happening and being influential within their space. There's a very strong ownership over their Chatswood, which was very nice and very interesting for them.
I went to like old local history books and like all these audio recordings and stuff like that. I think it was really interesting as well to see the way that like the aging like micro population here like really seems to like genuinely like really love this place. And like as well they talk about how like a lot of their like multicultural organizations like have kind of like a lot of other councils have lost interest in them. And they're like really council still like making a good effort to like keep on like including us in see like a different perspective of like just like the way that I grew up and to see how people still like genuinely like dealing with this place.
Yeah. They definitely do. When I started working here about 3 years ago, I couldn't believe like how full it was. There's so many great things. So in my events team, we have a mission to make Chatswood cool to the people external, so you guys are very much part of that.
Yes, the Zara part. What would you think is probably the most challenging aspect of any one particular idea you're working on that's so well expected as the character from the original germ of an idea through to the concept, to putting it on paper, to reality, to installation? What was the most challenging aspect of that work for you?
It's a very good question. I think with any work, it obviously comes from an idea and a concept, a fantastical concept that we dreamed up, that we have an image of in our head. And I think with all projects, the parrots, Cascading, like, it is the, all right, yes, we've got it across the line, we've solved it. How on earth do we do this? And it's that period of brainstorming of trying these different ideas and experimenting with them, and when things don't go to plan, when things continually fail, but it is also the best way to do part of the job as well. Because through that process, you do have that aha moment where it finally works in the middle of the night after hours of working out, trying a million different materials and techniques, and then it does come together. So I'd say it's the most challenging and the best part of the job.
Just follow up on that. I think lots of people have amazing ideas, but the beauty that both of you have is that you actually have the skills and the technical know-how to make them a reality. What pathways did you, what education and what skills did you learn, or what was your journey to get here to do these installations?
Yes. competing, I started doing shows, so I had the opportunity to tour through Asia and Australia doing my shows. I worked out that I very much wanted to be in the entertainment industry. So from there, after high school, I studied spatial architecture, which is a degree that focuses on exhibition and event design and designing spaces, essentially. After I finished uni, I got the one job that I could last year, was actually a fashion designer. I hated the job from day one, but I stuck it out for 10 months until I realized that I really hated the job. But by that point, it had really pushed me to explore why I studied my degree. I took an internship with a company called Bandlight, which is doing production lighting and sculptural design. From there, I worked freelance with a couple of other people who work in that industry. I was working as a graphic designer, doing set design with Disney. I had a lot of great opportunities that gave me the confidence to pursue my own design practice, which is kind of a design studio, which I've essentially picked all my favorite parts of the industry. So obviously, I spend my time making giant toys. Which obviously I've been given skills through university and working alongside other people doing similar things to allow me to do that. Thanks. And to your question.
What's your educational journey?
Right. So I actually said that you also learn design, but they didn't really teach me all that much, so at least technically. And so I think honestly, if I learned how to teach, it would honestly be YouTube. It's just, yeah, it's like the internet is like an amazing place for like free resources and like tutorials. I literally just sat on my computer and just watched days and days of tutorials and like how to like learn like some techniques and stuff like that, and like how to work like through programs. But in terms of like projection mapping, it was just a friend who was like, oh, well, I'm looking for like a skill swap. We got to learn animation, we got to learn how to do projection mapping, and it basically took like, honestly, maybe like a whole year, and then we just kind of traded skills, and yeah, he's also got like his own visual installation, and his house, so yeah.
So just hearing what you
were
saying, collaboration.
Sure, I mean, collaboration is crucial, I think, in all industries, particularly the design industry. You can't become an expert at everything. Right? Everyone has that one thing that they're passionate about that they naturally become an expert in. And that's what makes your team crucial, finding those people around you that are experts in what you need. So I work with a strong team. I work with Chris Diamond, who's a creative technologist. I collaborate frequently with friends or my partner. He's an industrial designer and sculptor. So working with those different perspectives that come together to create something that is actually successful, and I think that's really crucial, always.
Yeah, I would agree with that. I think it's mostly about like different perspectives. I think I asked Gambirra to work with me on this project because we are like actually very, very different people. And like the work that she produces is not, I wouldn't say it's necessarily like what I personally enjoy, but I know that she brings like a completely different like perspective. I know that it's objectively good. Like I wouldn't personally like listen to it, but I know that objectively like it has like a different kind of audience, and it has like a, and I think it's really important if I'm trying to like create like an artwork about like inclusivity and like different perspectives, and it's actually get an artist who is like very different to that. We work very differently. I think that's I think that's just a part of the process of like making something that we are looking at. So
on that piece, Gambirra, to the music
and all the indigenous paintings and stuff like that. So.
Which I think definitely add a musical element. It sounds like it's fantastic.
Yeah.
It's great. Do you have any more questions?
Just like put yourself out there, like I think just like Yeah, I think that'd be the main thing, just throwing yourself out there and just expecting value. I just kind of... I was just like throwing it out like wherever it goes and then things hit. Most things don't play, like it's important just to like keep on trying.
We all laugh, but I think it's very true, unfortunately. Maybe not to expect failure, but not be too worried to almost... So when I started out, I sent a lot of cold emails. I didn't really know anyone in the industry. My family doesn't have a very design background, so it was really up to me to figure out to make those connections. And I sent a lot of just cold emails that I wasn't expecting responses from, and that was essentially it. I actually had the opportunity to take part in the Senior Chatswood because of that. I saw the event last year, and also the years before that. Last year I was obviously in the industry, and I sent an email to the council saying, I really want to be involved, how do I do this? And didn't hear anything back at first until EY's process was starting to come out, and Juliet got in contact and invited me to submit some proposals, which came out of those desperate cold emails, talking to people that I wanted to work with. I was looking around the industry to see people who were doing what I wanted to do. Essentially, just touching base, saying, how on earth did you do this? Can I work with you? Can you teach me how to do this?
It's actually too fun how I've done it. I saw the carrots and I've been vivid and I took a photo, so I knew who it was because I was going to investigate. And then I remembered that someone had sent me an email who'd been involved in vivid and I found it, and then you had done the carrots, so I went, okay, because I love carrots. So,
thank you.
So the cold emails are definitely.
Just on that same theme, I think that so resilience is really important. But what percentage of your works are the ideas that you have, and then you try to put them together and make them a bit acceptable? Something, what percentage just do not work? And you have to repeat it. And I'm not tweaking them, but with it, it's just not going to work.
That's a good question.
Any more questions, please?
both of your sites spent time then with the council, and it's been wonderful to see the community engagement. I want to know, how does it feel? Because to me, it just felt joyful watching all the age groups, different nationalities, all walks of life engaging in the installations. What does it feel like when you see people, or being a job that brings so much joy to people, producing these installations?
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely my minute. I would be lying because I wasn't guilty of standing up the top in that middle level, but looking at Cascading Park and just watching people. Look, and that's essentially why I do what I do. I like the entertainment itself and seeing people interact in something that I've imagined and that does bring the same joy to me as it does to other people.
Yeah, I think it's generally like a little overwhelming. And it's really cool to see, like, just because random people don't have any investment in your person and like any artwork or like the work that you make, and just seeing them like actually just watch it and be interested. Yeah, I think it's like really great. Because you have your friends and your friends will say it's great, but you have no idea if that's actually true. So it's good to like have just like random people actually like appreciate it and like watch it. So yeah.
This is your first major public artwork,
yeah,
isn't it?
Totally, yeah.
It's first experience of just random,
yeah,
strangers.
Yeah, I think, yeah, all the other artworks that we make, we like invite all the people. We have, you know, we like invite like, a whole bunch of people, so we're mostly just like friends. And so it is just like, I guess that every trip, it's just nice to get out of that and to have that, and to have just like random people being like, oh no, I hate it, or like, I love it, you know? It's, yeah.
Have you been guilty of standing next to your installation?
I stand next to like a bit, but not like a huge amount. I'm really like, planning to go back like a couple times soon, so yeah.
Something else I will add to that,
that
I don't know if you've heard, but I have definitely experienced, which is an interesting takeaway, is also seeing the social media side of it, seeing how people are taking and interpreting the work in very different ways. So particularly Cascading Harp, seeing the different angles people are able to appreciate this from, it's fantastic. So I'm scrolling through the social media going, oh yeah, okay, I'm gonna go take it from that angle tonight, which is really rewarding.
Thank you to Zara and Chris for their amazing work and their time this morning. Thank you.